It's the morning of day 5 on the MacKenzie Trail. We are camped just off the airstrip, which was last night's goal. Supposedly, there is a lodge, a short walk from here, and a few of us head down to the lake to check it out. And Zach volunteers to cook up some grub.
I'll have breakfast when you get back!
Down at the lake, and to our surprise, the lodge is burned to the ground. Only charred foundations remain of the main structures. Items left behind tell a story of a livelihood gone by. Kurt, the ghost town hunter, compares old pictures to piece together the yard.
And in between the bridge and the water was a cabin on your right.
That's that cabin. The same angle and everything.
It is.
And there's that aspen.
We are very lucky that we hadn't counted on this location for any resources. Back at camp, we are fed and gearing up for the day when an unexpected visitor rolls up. It's a family that lives in a nearby lodge and are very curious about what made all the noise last night deep in the forest.
I heard you guys cutting at midnight.
Immediately, trail recon questions follow.
What's that?
How long has it been since someone's been through
here? Years now. Probably a couple of years since anybody's cut it out like you guys did.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Did you drive it this morning and see?
No.
Oh. We just came straight down.
Any idea what the road's like heading out of here?
Not good.
Not good?
Nobody's been out that way in quite a while.
Yeah.
Probably not very good.
Last I was up there with Abby, it was wet. Just wet.
Well, the wind falls.
And then the wind storms. Yeah.
The lake is the first one. That's 15 miles.
Okay. What's that? Tizzy?
There's Tizzy Lake.
That's on the trail here.
Yeah, that's the old Pan Phillips' resort.
Oh, that's the one, the Pan Phillips. Yeah.
You'll hit that in 15 miles.
We were aiming for that one tonight.
Okay, you'll probably make her there.
Okay.
You'll be late.
Yeah. So if we've got those kinds of roads, how many days do you think to get out?
I don't even know where it'd be cut to.
So we're going to go out to, I think it's Gacho Lake?
Agacho
Lake, and then head south down to Anaheim is our plan.
Oh my gosh. I don't know, guys.
Okay, a couple days.
At least. Well, you seen what you had?
Yeah.
And that road was cut out. You come through Kluskas, right?
We did.
And was there a lot of cutting from Kluskas to my place?
Wasn't too bad. They had cleared it.
They cleared it up
to the Mushu Junction.
Yeah.
And then from there on, we were... You know, cutting sporadically.
Oh, yeah.
How many days did they say cutting 2 days it was to get from our place?
Yeah, and that was this spring. And then that storm went through, and you guys had to cut that out. And this up here.
It's not been cut in years. No. Well, wish us luck. We'll be.
You bet, guys.
Pushing hard, I guess. Out just a few minutes here.
Okay. Well, you know where we are if you break down and need somebody.
And that's awesome.
See if I can let them know upriver that you guys are all coming.
Thank you.
Get your heads up.
That's great. Yep. Okay.
It's good to see some other faces.
Kind yeah. Of
no kidding.
Despite the local intel, the trail ahead is still a mystery.
Hey guys, have fun. See ya. Surprising news, but it's kind of like, okay, here we go. In it again.
Yeah.
If he said some sections of that hadn't been done in a couple years, and they did that last fall.
Right. It could be better than what we've seen so far.
Sure. That's true. And we don't know how far they did that either. They didn't say they did it all the way to
the Pan Phillips.
The Pan Phillips Lodge.
Well, he did say he thought we could get there today.
He
doesn't know how robust we are.
Yeah, he doesn't know. He don't know.
Well, some of us prep saws and gear. Others are refilling the water tank in the XB3 down at the lake. Kurt finds some time to think about what could be.
If I had to name a fear moving forward, it would just be time and pace. We've kind of got some hard deadlines to get out of the trail, just people flying home and people needing to get home. And it could be to the point where we're just not making that pace. We've had some 10-mile days. We had a 20-mile day yesterday. We're hoping to do another 15, 20 miles today, but you know, if we fall short on that, that just means bigger days those following days. So it could start getting real early mornings and late nights to make it happen, which we're prepared to do, but I don't know that our fuel will necessarily hold out if we have to push it that hard too. So the fuel could once again become a scare. I think we're good, but it could be a scare.
We hyper-focus on a diligent schedule and making our daily miles. It's the only thing we can do to make sure that we get out on time. Only a quarter mile past the airstrip, the recent storm's wrath is evident. It's an endless stretch of mangled deadfall. Progress is slow, and over the course of 8 hours, we make our way past the lake, where the trail has become boggy and thick with mosquitoes.
Through it. It's gonna take more time than we planned, but we had that allowed. So we're making like a half, maybe more like a quarter mile an hour when we've got to be doing all this cutting. So you add that up, that's a lot of hours. There's
probably
not enough of,
miles today.
Not enough of them in the day. When was the last time it took you 8 hours to go like 4 miles?
I think it was 2013 at the beginning of the MacKenzie Trail, sound right?
I think that's me too.
We can tackle all kinds of stuff if morale's good, but man, if morale falls apart, we all fall apart. And then we get upset and people get mad and mistakes start to happen and accidents can happen. And so you're just really thinking ahead on all this. You know, we're averaging less than half a mile an hour, and we're cutting every square inch of it, so.
Yeah.
That's tough, man.
It is tough
work. And looking forward, looking out ahead, it's going to be the same thing, so we may be in for a lot more work. Just chainsaws are getting a workout. You know, you can prepare and prepare and prepare, and sometimes you find that you don't have everything you need, and that's one of the things that just got left was the chainsaw sharpening tool set. So we brought extra chains, but a mistake was made there somewhere along the way, and we're just having to work with what we got.
It's clearing a trail.
There you go, yeah.
Got it.
The very end of the lake is really soft. The Tacoma is losing the battle in the bog.
See if you can get a little bit of a bump into it.
I think we're dug in now, man.
Yeah, you are.
That almost dug us in a little more. You're on the max tracks here. You're not here. Okay.
We kick into full recovery mode. Max tracks and the winch will be used in conjunction to achieve the fastest results as we battle for ground in the bog ahead.
Just get a couple logs behind his tires, you know, find something to kind of button him up against, otherwise I may drag him towards me.
Okay.
I'll get you out, Kurt. I earned it. I'm just giving a crap.
What am I doing as far as turning to get back on those max tracks?
Straight is straight up
just,
on them.
Just go. Okay.
Give yeah, I turn a little driver.
Okay.
Driver. good. Okay, here we go. Here we go. Tension. Coming up.
Man, are you in a bog or something?
Yeah, do you want me to keep, do you want to reset max track?
We're still stuck.
Okay, Ty, we're gonna have to go forward again.
Truck pulling the trailer, every time the trailer hits a bump, it just pretty much locks the truck down and we start sinking into the bog. We found back there, you don't sink down to the axles with no time at all.
So we were up cutting trail, and apparently these guys got themselves stuck down here. So we didn't think it was that wet when we came up, but who knows, we may have rutted it up before them. We're going back to see what's going on. Apparently they got winches out.
We get there in time, so just got in.
Yeah, hopefully we waited just long enough.
Hey gentlemen.
Hey.
Good, pretty good. This bog's just a little bit for the Tacoma right now. I mean, we loaded up how many pounds of water this morning? Just working our way out. We can't have it easy. MacKenzie's gonna make us pay for it.
Wait till you see what's in store for tomorrow.
Hush your mouth.
If I cut hard down, am I gonna clear that jow?
Yeah.
But is the trailer gonna clear, guys?
No.
Okay.
Come straight for a little longer.
Whoa. Wait.
You're gonna have to do, I don't know.
Ten full winch lines later, we are free from the bog.
I think he's home free at this point.
Well, an hour later, we're through all the bog. So we got all the vehicles and we're just about in a spot that we can drive on our own. We're coming out of this little soft marshy spot. We're gonna get up on top and camp for the night. It's been a long day. Our progress has been pretty mediocre, like a quarter mile an hour between all the cutting and the bogs. We knew we'd be gonna get into some slow parts, so we're not completely discouraged, but we gotta pick up the pace. We're not gonna have enough fuel to get through the trail. We're gonna be in another fuel crunch.
Okay, we're gonna pack up winch. Good job, Kurt.
Well, at this point in time, find what's ever level.
Yeah.
Because right beyond me is about an hour's worth of work to go about a tenth of a mile.
Really?
Oh yeah, it's bad. I'm not joking.
Everyone's gonna sleep well tonight.
These are our tracks to here. Now we're into day six. Is that jive? Yeah. Day six.
Brightish.
Okay, this big long track out here is our fuel run and back, and we've made it from there to here on half a tank of fuel. We're averaging 35 miles to the tank, which is just over
That's some good MPG.
Just over 1 miles to the gallon. It's 21.1 gallon tank. We figured it was almost 90 miles of trail fuel. Left.
No, 55 a trail.
55 a trail, 90 to right? fuel.
Yep.
And we have roughly 35 gallons of vehicle to do it. Do the math. At this rate, we'll never make it. Pan Phillips is 6 miles from here, 5 miles-ish. And if it's like yesterday, it'll take us all day to get there because it took us 9 hours to go 6 miles yesterday. So when we get there, that's a lodge that's supposed to be open. Hopefully they're there, which I think they will be. We'll get our last bit of info. Hopefully some trails open up. Hopefully our miles per gallon picks up because we're traveling. What's killing us is the idling, obviously. So we might actually have to start leaving trucks way back and moving them, like walking even more, and then leapfrogging big chunks where we can not have to idle as much, etc. And then if it all comes down to it, we'll have to really get creative on our fuel, how to get fuel, that we're approaching a point of no return or a point of total commitment.
So it sounds like a lot of it needs to come from, a decision needs to be made after we get a lot of good intel from Pan Phillips.
From Pan Phillips. That's where we're at today.
For hope.
Okay. All right, so Clay and Ty and I are gonna go ahead of everyone else and start cutting while everyone tears down camp. We just did a quick breakfast just so we can get a jump start on the day. There's stuff right over this little hill that's gonna take a while to cut through. So we're gonna probably spend most of our day cutting. This is the thickest that we've ever gotten into and we need to make quick work of it. So here we go.
Just checking the diff oil again this morning, making sure that our level's looking good, making sure that we're just keeping oil in there at this point so that we don't fry something. Good to go.
Well, I got a fun game this morning. Party foul.
Yeah, the clip on that thing broke.
Oh. Oh, yeah.
An hour later, the truck team heads out to meet up with the trail crew.
These guys up front are doing a ton of work right now. And really did a good job cutting this trail. I mean, we're averaging right now 2 miles an hour or so. We're flying right now. I don't know, it sounds like they're still moving, so this just made our morning right now, to be able to just get out and get on the trail. So we'll switch them out, but they're doing a phenomenal job.
However, our good progress is in danger due to our saws becoming more and more dull with every cut.
There's an hour and 7 minutes to go 0.7 miles.
That's a little discouraging. We worked for an hour and 15 minutes?
Seven minutes.
An hour and 7 minutes. And we went exactly 0.7 miles. I thought we were at least a mile into this thing. Mm-hmm. I told Jeff that I don't know, 300 yards ago, I told him I thought we were a mile in.
When we left.
So,
it's floating a little bit, yeah.
Just inch by inch.
A new system naturally takes shape. The first cutting crew will now rest at the trucks, and the next cutting team heads up the way. An hour later, we will start the trucks and move up, rotating teams again.
Just some minor oversights on our part are turning into a huge, huge issue right now. One chainsaw is virtually down right now because it has a dull blade, obviously, from what we've been doing. We brought a second chain for it, but the chain is the wrong chain. Slight oversight at the store, big problem out here. The secondary issue is we have two chains for the other chainsaw, but they're both starting to get dull and we don't have a sharpener. We're really concentrating on every cut that we make. We're trying to move the small stuff by hand out of the way and make as few cuts as possible just so that we can save the one chain and We are praying that we can get through this next couple of miles to hopefully find a chain sharpener to where we can get good chains back, get two chainsaws back up and running, and continue to push forward. If not, we have a severe issue to where we might have to end up turning around at dead in our tracks, because this obviously is not stopping. So.
The time's the killer, so it's the 11th today. I think we have to be off the trail by the 15th. So that's just three more days. But three more days at this pace.
No way.
That's 21 miles.
Yeah, because we have 50 trail miles to do, right?
55 as of this morning. I'm gonna say 53 after right now. Really?
All right, well, back to it.
We're moving strong, just wanted to let you guys know.
Thanks, brother, I hear you half a mile in.
How far do we make it?
Are you ready for the big number? How far do you think you went?
1.2 miles.
1.2?
2.5, or 2.0.
1.7, I'm going 1. big.
1.7? 0.9.
What?
Yeah. 0.9? 0.9. Well, let's keep, until the whole gravy train gets here, let's run.
The shift method dramatically conserves fuel over idling and moving in short increments. We work four rotations. During shift change 5, we gather to face reality.
We're probably going to hit the same exact stuff we've been hitting here for the next at least 4 or 5 miles. From what I think we can see probably 4 miles. So, the question is that, what do we say, Setsi Lake? Is that Setsi Lake? Or, and if so, you know, would it be smart to send somebody forward to kind of go scout it out, go see if anybody's at the Pan Phillips Lodge, see what kind of help they can give us. And if not, we need to, this thing is now...
Yeah, we have a growing concern with our chainsaws. We obviously are down one already.
This fella is got the tensioner screw, half of it is sheared off now. I don't know when it got cranked on, but I was tightening it just a little bit and it sheared right off. So
this is by far and above the most chainsawing we've ever done on this trail. Last time and this time.
Yeah.
This nuts.
And as the deeper we go in here, the deeper we have to crawl back out if we do have to turn around. So it might be wise to send somebody up there just to see what they have.
One of my thoughts is that we bail out right here. We go around the other side. We start working our way in from the back end of the trail to map it. Because the mission is to map it and do as much of it as we can. And I would hate to burn up all the remainder days right here doing these 2 miles, when if we were to back out, go around the other side, and come back in the other way, we would get a whole lot more of it done.
Yeah.
Now, right now, we got the fuel to get back out. We know there's an exit at the airstrip. We're gonna maximize our time and maximize everything. I'm with you, the chainsaw is the worst part of this. If that goes down, we're totally done. And if we have to back out and there's stuff that's falling in behind us.
Right.
I was going to the bathroom over there and saw a tree fall over. So let's turn around, go out.
Okay.
All right.
Was it a consideration or a consideration have someone run ahead? It means setting up camp here. Put us another day, but we're a couple miles. We could be there in an hour and send a couple people to hike into that lodge and see if there's an egress point right there. I mean, would that make it worth it fighting 2 more miles this way?
That's probably enough justification there.
I'm to certainly send a guy. Indifferent.
We got to send 2 guys though. Close.
It could end up being that the trail is cut from here on to there. You know, they may have done it yesterday. You never know.
Yeah. I agree. Let's get 2 guys geared up to go.
We'll get some bear spray and some other miscellaneous crap.
Okay.
And we'll head out.
Cool.
Yeah, we're doing good. So,
tons of light.
In a great example of total team awareness and decision making, we decided to take a minimal time risk to assess the trail ahead by sending a 3-man team 3 miles up the way to investigate the lodge and hopefully any trail conditions beyond it.
Be safe. Hey, if anything gets in your way, turn. Or step over it.
Map and radio in hand, Scott, Ryan, and Zach take up the trail. Meanwhile, all trail cutting will stop in an effort to save our remaining half-dulled chainsaw in the event we have to backtrack and clear out our exit trail.
Even right now, I'm not very optimistic unless the roads just crazy improve. The other end of this 2.5 miles, we have several bogs and one's a bad bog. And we're gonna be in here probably for another day to 2 days just getting to the lodge. So we'll see. We'll see what kind of update we get on the other end of this and go from there.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, it's a windmill.
Wow.
Woo. Knock on the door.
Hey there.
Well, hello.
How are you? How's it going?
Where did you guys come from?
In the middle of the woods. That's where we came from. I'm Zach.
Rob.
Rob, nice to meet you, Rob.
Right.
Yeah, so we just kind of came to get some information and maybe you have a chainsaw sharpener.
These guys are cutting out the wagon road.
Yes!
We're trying. We're trying.
Oh, I'm so glad.
Yeah.
Truck team, you got a copy?
Got a copy.
Oh, nice. Nice. We have landed and she is beautiful here.
Are you at the airstrip there?
Yes, we are. And we're getting coffee.
Very nice. You just went at exactly 2 miles, 1.99.
Yeah, that's the way the crow flies. The trail is just right at 3 miles.
Copy.
How do you guys feel about chapping up and get moving?
We can chap up and get moving.
What is the information on past camp?
Past camp is allegedly completely cut and good to go.
Copy. So allegedly, past camp is completely cut and ready to go.
Right now it is 5 to 6, and our current rates of travel are 1/2 mile per hour at best.
We're looking at 3 hours of cutting and going.
Yeah, I'd say 4 to 5 to be safe.
With winching.
There's a little bit of cutting you'll have to do to kind of get through the Indian village that we were at.
And then there's a water crossing. And then there's probably about 1/2 mile of cutting, and then it's gonna clear up into a bad bog, like worst one we've been in, that will definitely need winching. And then you're gonna have about another solid mile of bad cutting.
And then you'll roll into camp.
Copy that, that's all great information. We'll get to cutting in a sauna. Are you guys gonna come back?
How about we'll cut from this end?
You will come back?
They got a cabin.
Maybe you're when breaking up.
Can't hear you.
Trail team out.
Copy that. Pay revoked.
What did he say?
He said, copy that. Pay revoked.
Well, crap.
We'll finish our coffee.
We'll finish our coffee.
Sounds better right now.
We'll finish our coffee, head your direction, and meet up in the middle somewhere.
All right, we're going to suit up and get to cutting.
Roger. See you in a few.
What a huge relief that the trail ahead will be free. It would have been a huge mistake on my part to have backed out earlier in the day. It goes to show that a rash decision made with good intentions can still be a bad one. The trail ahead is not easy. We still have a bunch of work ahead.
Oh,
We took a shortcut. And he said he might be a little wet. But it's way wet. Not worth the shortcut sometimes.
At sunset, our crews finally rejoin.
Hey guys!
How's it going?
They said from that lodge, 9 hours to Anaheim Lake. And it's cut the whole way.
Well, and if it's smooth going and we're rolling, we have the fuel to do it.
Yeah. And
now with local radio frequencies established, we attempt to make contact with the lodge from our position.
Phillips Lodge, this is Expedition Overland on Plateau North.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hey, how are you doing tonight?
Oh, not too bad. How are things going down there?
Things are going great. This is Clay Croft, expedition leader of Expedition Overland. Pleasure to meet you.
Yeah, for sure.
I have you at 1.48 miles from you. I think we'll be to you probably for lunch tomorrow. How's that sound?
Oh yeah, sure, sounds good.
All right, well, you have a beautiful evening, and we'll catch you tomorrow.
You betcha, and you guys too.
All right, will do. XO out.
Bye for now.
What a cool dude.
Cool dude.
Seems like a cool dude.
Dude's the best news ever.
Oh.
You know how much of a relief that is?
Can't smell the barn. We gotta stay smart.
True, very true.
We're not there. And then we still have 9 hours on a wagon road trail to get out.
Yeah, and that is like his rough estimate, and I don't think he takes that trail on a regular basis. So
we need to budget 12.
There could be some challenges.
Okay. Yeah, we're not out of the woods yet.
We're not out of the woods.
We're not in the clear.
Out of the woods yet.
No.
We're in the clear.
As dinner is prepared, the saws are sharpened for one more day of clearing with our newly borrowed tools. We as a team have a new spring in our step, a sense of calm after a long day on a very special trail. If everything goes right tomorrow, we may complete the mapping of the MacKenzie Trail for HEMA and future explorers.
Oh, it's light.
Couple of going.
There you go.
It's been one for the books, that's for sure. Old crews join together with the new, opening up new friendships and big potential. The days ahead should be our finest. But to get there, you have to cross one more
bar. I'm like six and six or seven. Siphoning fuel into the vehicles this morning. So we have 10 gallons. We're gonna throw the Tacoma and 5 each in the 4Runners. Our hopes are not only we need to top off the tanks, but lighten up the trailer. We know we've got a pretty legit bog section coming up. So getting 20 gallons, which is a couple hundred pounds off of the trailer essentially, is gonna help us pay favors when we get into that mud section. We're hoping it makes the trailer sink in less. So.
We figure there are two approaches to this bog. A, take it on with momentum and spin and rip until we reach the other side or get stuck, which in turn will be harder and harder to do with each passing truck. Or, systematically approach the problem and disturb the trail as little as possible. We decide to approach the bog systematically.
I think we should air down. Okay.
The classic MaxTrax road will be laid down in front to act like snowshoes, spreading out the weight of the truck over the soft bottom. The winch lines will be ready if the truck slips into the bog.
We can just leapfrog them. Do we want the other four? Good. Slow, slow, slow. Okay, you're on it. Hold there. Yep. That's a first. That's how you clear out max tracks.
What the heck happened there?
That's how you get all of them out of the mud, you know?
Yeah, you're.
We meant to do that.
So we got three.
Keep going.
Through, you know, actually with all those max tracks, it was a nice steady bottom. We never even, I don't think we had to really even spin tires. We crawled right through. Tacoma will be the real test because it's heavier, and that, especially over the back end of that pickup and then dragging that trailer.
Beat on both ends here.
Ty, you need another one, or should we kind of send him a little bit? Go at least a foot.
I'm gonna throw my last one in.
Send it.
Between max tracks and our newly proven X3 tires, one must fight off the feeling of being invincible.
You're clear, you're clear!
It destroyed the bridge.
Come on.
You're on track now, little passenger. Let's just slow down, just nice and slow through here. A couple hours later, the final tree is cut. We can now reach the lodge. The lodge is a welcomed bit of hospitality. Rob and Linda have worked hard to carve out a life here. Everything is handmade or flown in by airplane. They fed us a great lunch and told us to tag the old tractor before sending us on our way. If you're ever in the area, stop by for some of Linda's awesome chili and cinnamon rolls at Pan Phillips Lodge.
Well, you're just gonna have to let us know when you get out to the road.
We will. We'll make
as
sure
soon
we get
as you guys get hooked up, let us know what the road's like going that way.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, absolutely.
So we're halfway down the runway and take a right.
Yep. Go through an old fence and go stay to the right.
Well, that was cool.
Very cool.
The trail completely opens up at the end of the runway and continues that way the remaining 20 miles before diving to the south another 50 miles, ending in the small town of Anaheim Lake. It was absolutely exhilarating to know that today we finished the job. The good trail provided a perfect opportunity to reach one last objective. An objective beyond the reach of any vehicle. In true Overland fashion, we are now on board the vessel Whispering Winds, on our way to locate Alexander's Rock, the historical landmark where on July 22, 1793, Alexander MacKenzie reached the Pacific coast. Wrote his name at the water's edge, testifying to his discovery that changed the course of history forever.
A lot of people think that Lewis and Clark were the first people to cross North America, but Alexander MacKenzie crossed it 12 years sooner than they did up here. So this rock is really significant for American history.
I've got a huge grin on my face. It's awesome.
So in what I was reading, he picked this point. He decided to pick this point because he could have a good view to the south. He needed a good view to the south so that he could get a good celestial reading. So it's all making sense now because you can actually see pretty far to the south. It's the first time on this stretch that we've even been able to see to the south. So it's all coming together. It's pretty cool.
I'm gonna jump in there.
It's kind of enchanted here. We're under the canopy of the rainforest a little bit, and it's just beautiful. You can only imagine what it's like to make this the end of your journey across Canada to find the ocean. It's also feeling good that it's the end of our journey too.
That looks like steps.
Oh, you're right. Yeah, I think we go up. Go for it.
Boys, we did it.
She's here.
Oh, oh, there it is.
Weird.
One, two, three, go.
Let's go!
Whoa!
Whoa!
Everybody,
everybody good?
Woo!
Six steps!
Woo!
Couldn't ask for a better conclusion to a really awesome journey. So I think that was worth everything it took to get out here. We had to hunt around all over Bella Coola to find somebody willing to bring us out here. It's not a super common spot, and they don't exactly run boats out here all day. So we did. We found a fisherman willing to take us on his day off, and here we are, and it's awesome. Went for a swim, water was perfect. And we made it to the very end of the Canada land crossing that happened in 1793. So pretty epic place to be.
Overlanding is often thought about the journey, but it's fun to hit a destination every now and then, just as a little pinnacle of your travels.
I always thought trips like this were completely unattainable. But after experiencing this crew and really seeing what it takes to do something like this, it just made the world a bit a little smaller, and just the longing to see more of it. So,
and then what a great day to come down here, sit on the boat, and really just get to enjoy time with each other.
Hopefully more people come through and do it and get to experience the adventure. They're gonna have the same challenges we had because nature just has its way of tightening up that trail, so it should still be a good time. It'll be some work if you do it, but I'd encourage you to go see it. And we'll see what's next for us.
I really love adventuring because it's a quick way to introduce yourself to yourself. What you like and what you don't like about yourself, the things you'd like to change and the things that you love. And also, you know, you get to do it with this group of guys and you get to see how they operate and you get to glean off them. And that's where I'm at right now, and that's why I really love adventuring.
When life gives you second chances, you better pay attention. It just may be one of the best things you ever do. And who knows where some redeemed motivation will take you next.
Scott, take it at an angle. Scott, a little bit driver.
Driver.
Scott, driver, drive. Oh, okay, there we go.
There we go.
Okay, now you gotta bump it, Scott. You gotta bump it.
Oh.